Assalamu alaikum. Welcome back, students. Now we are starting our last chapter of this course, which is actually single phase induction motor. So we are actually starting chapter 9 of your book. Okay. So last time we studied about the three phase induction motor. So basically three phase induction motors are used for the high horsepower, high power requirements, high power application. Like for example, industry unit, so we have the high power requirements, so we use the three phase induction motors for the high power applications. Okay, but for the low power requirements, okay, so for example, such as like in the household applications, like you have the water pumps, or like you have fans, you have blowers, or like portable devices. So in all these devices we use the induction motors, okay, but like the power requirements of these devices is much lower, okay, as compared to the industrial power requirement. So for such devices, for the low horsepower, okay, or fractional horsepower, okay, fractional means low horsepower applications, we use a single phase induction motor. Okay, so instead of like constructing the three phase induction motor, we construct the single phase induction motor, because like we can compensate, we can meet the low power requirements with only one phase induction motor. Okay, so we will have the one phase supply, so you have our induction motor, and we will have the one phase output. Okay, so this is the just a brief comparison between the three phase and the single phase. Okay, of course, if your power requirements becomes like high and high, then of course we know that with the single phase, okay, we cannot supply high power. Okay, we have to shift to the three phase system. Okay, so and we use the three phase induction motor for such applications. So in this chapter, we briefly see some theory background, and then we will see the equivalent circuit model and some applications and some examples about that. So I will briefly cover the short theory, okay, and I will leave some of the theory parts, and you guys can study about those, okay, and I will switch to the main topic, which is actually the circuit model of the induction motor. So basically, if you talk about the construction, so the construction is similar to the three phase induction motor. Like we have a stator, okay, and like which is actually based off the laminated core, okay, with slots, and it has like these slots for the placement of the stator winding, and we have a rotor, and inside this stator we actually place the stator windings, and for the we supply the stator windings with the wires, which we actually called as main windings. Okay, so main windings are basically used to supply the voltage, input voltage, to the stator windings. Okay, so when the input voltage is applied to the stator windings, okay, we will have the stator magnetic field. Okay, so this is like the basic construction is similar, okay, but there are certain issues with the single phase induction motor. In three phase induction motors, we have learned that in the three phase case, okay, we get the rotating magnetic field, right? We get the rotating magnetic field. Due to the rotating magnetic field, we get the torque. Okay, and due to the torque, our rotor was rotating, right? That was the three phase induction motor case. Okay, but in the single phase induction motor, okay, let me draw the simplified case. Okay, for example, like this is my stator, and we usually have squirrel cage rotor. Okay, so like this is the squirrel cage rotor, that you have the squirrel and you have the bars here, okay, like here rotor's bars. So usually have the squirrel cage rotor, so I can draw the squirrel cage rotor here, like these are these rotor bars, we have the rotors here, and for the simplification, so we have the stator winding. So let me draw the stator winding for the simplified case, just like this one. This is my stator winding. and the current will be flowing through this one. Okay, for this applied single phase. Okay, through the stator windings using the main windings. Okay, so let's say you have supplied this AC current. Let's say sinusoidal AC current, one phase sinusoidal AC current we are supplying. Okay, this is the current I. Okay, now for this current I, okay, when the current will flow through the stator windings, okay, we will have the flux, right? So I can draw the flux, which will be actually proportional to the flowing current, right? So the flux will be proportional to this one, or you can like the flux will corresponding will be proportional to the stator magnetic field, okay, with this some proportionality constants. Okay, so now what is actually happening? Okay, let's analyze this case for the different time periods. Okay, let's say this is the complete time period, and I'm dividing this time period into four parts. Okay, let's say this is t is equal to 0. So when at t is equal to 0, if we see, okay, at t is equal to 0, I'm dealing about the flux. Okay, so at t is equal to 0, we can see that our flux is 0, right? Flux is 0, and at t is equal to t1, okay, at t is equal to t1, our flux is increasing towards the positive value, right? Our flux is increased to the positive value. So first, like it was 0, okay, for this case, and then it increased towards the positive maximum, right? So this is the maximum, positive maximum, okay? Then if we see the next case, like this one, t is equal to t2. So now at t2, again your flux is, so flux decreases from positive maximums to 0, okay? So it goes to the positive maximum, and then from here, from the positive maximum, it again goes back to the 0 value, right? At t is equal to this one. And now at t3, okay, again from the 0, it will go to the negative maximum, right? Okay, and t is equal to t4, again from the negative maximum, okay, it will go back to the 0. Okay, so if we just analyze this case for the one complete cycle, so what we are having, we are having the zero flux here at this time. It's going to the positive maximum, okay, at t1, then coming back to the zero at t2, and then going back to the negative maximum at t3, and then coming back again at t4, right? So t0, okay. So basically your flux, okay, is just fluctuating. Okay, we are having the like positive flux, we are having the negative flux, okay? So it's just fluctuating between the zero points, okay? So basically, we are not having the rotating magnetic field here, okay? So here in this case, your flux is just fluctuating between the maximum and the minimum value, okay? Fluctuating flux, or we call this as pulsing flux. Okay, so due to the fluctuating flux or pulsing flux, we will have the fluctuating magnetic field or pulsing magnetic field. Okay, so inside of the the single phase induction motor, the stator magnetic field is actually fluctuating magnetic field, not the rotating magnetic field. Okay, so we know that we need the actually rotating magnetic field so that we can actually, the torque can be induced and the rotor can be rotated. So like you can see here, so now as the flux is just like the magnetic field is just fluctuating, okay, so the net, there will be no rotating magnetic field, okay? So but like when the when this magnetic field, okay, this stator magnetic field is like changing, so the changing magnetic field, it will actually induce the current in the rotor, right? And the rotor is the like squirrel cage. Okay, we have the shorted bar here, so the current will be flowing through the bar of the rotor. So when the current will be flowing through the bar of the rotor, we will get the induced flux, right? So the rate of change of this flux, okay, it will induce the current in the rotor, and we will have the flux resulting magnetic field in the rotor, okay. But we know that using the Lorentz law, okay, the induced flux in the rotor will oppose the change, right? The induced flux in the rotor, will oppose the change, right? Okay, it means, let me draw. So it means if this is the stator flux, then the rotor flux will be like this one. It will be opposing this stator flux, okay, as per the Lenz's law. Okay, now actually what is happening? So we get one magnetic field, which is the stator magnetic field, and we get another magnetic field, which is the rotor magnetic field. So like if we see here, the stator flux, like if like for example at this stage, again at t is equal to 0, stator magnetic field and the rotor magnetic field are in phase, right? The same phase, 0 degree. So we know that for the torque, we need the Br into Bs, so it's 0 degree, so our torque will be 0 degree, right? Now for example, if we see at this stage, okay, now we have the both stator magnetic field and the rotor magnetic field are 1 degree out of phase, right? So again, sine of 180, it will be 0. So again, if we check for the other points again, so for every points, okay, we will be either having the stator and the rotor magnetic field will be aligned or will be totally opposite of each other, okay? So what will happen due to this thing, the net induced torque in the rotor will be 0. So when the net induced torque in the rotor is 0, so there will be no rotation of the rotor. Okay, so it means what we can conclude from this discussion, that induction motor is not self-starting motor. Okay, so that is the one problem with induction motor, that is not self-starting, because when we just supply the one phase supply, the net induced torque is 0 and the rotor cannot rotate. Okay, so this is the problem with the induction motor. Okay, so what could be the possible solutions? Okay, so the possible solution are, like we discussed earlier on, for example, you have this stator and we have one rotor here. This is the squirrel cage rotor. Okay, so the one way is like you use some external generator that applied the external generator to the shaft of the rotor, and like by using this external generator you rotate this rotor, and once like it goes to the operating speed, okay, at that time, okay, you like disconnect the external generator and apply the one phase supply to the stator. So rotor will be rotating and we will get the desired functionality. But this is not the practical solution, right? Like applying another separate practical the external generator to just rotate the rotor. Okay, so how we solve this problem? Okay, so this was the issue with the induction motors. Then so this is just the details, go through this one. So this is just the animation which is just explaining that the fluctuating magnetic field, okay. And this is again another theory, which is the double revolving theory. I'm not going into the details of this theory. So this theory is proving the same thing, that basically the net induced torque, okay, net induced torque in the single phase induction motor will be 0. Okay, so you can go through this theory. Okay, so this theory is just explained the same concept which I have explained you here, that the net induced torque will be 0, so there will be no fluctuation, no rotation of the motor in the induction motor case. Okay, now the question is how we can actually start the single phase induction motor. Okay, so for the start of the induction motor, okay, there are different ways. Okay, so the easiest way is, okay, that we have the stator winding. Okay, we are calling this as main winding. Okay, and the current, like the stator current, is flowing through this one. So we use another winding, which is actually called we call it as auxiliary winding. Okay, so the purpose of the auxiliary winding is that auxiliary winding will be placed 90 degree of the stator winding. Okay, so for example, if this is the stator winding, then the auxiliary winding will be placed 90 degree of this one here. Okay, so that the current, okay, like let's say this is the main field winding, and let's say this is the auxiliary current. Okay, main field, so let's represent using IA, main field, and this is the auxiliary, so let's represent using IA. So we place the 90 degree, okay, 90 electrical degree apart from each other, so that the current in the auxiliary winding, okay, it will lead the main winding current. Okay, so basically we will have the two currents which are 90 degree apart from each other. So when two currents are 90 degree apart from each other, okay, then we will get the two magnetic fields. Okay, so for example, one could be the magnetic field of the rotor, auxiliary winding, and the other magnetic field could be of the main winding. Okay, because the auxiliary winding is 90 degree, it's like leading the main winding current, so its magnetic field, okay, the magnetic field which is being generated by the so the current in the IA leads the IM. Okay, so basically the magnetic field, okay, which is being generated due to the BM, they will be 90 degree of each other. So when they are 90 degree of each other, so now we are having the two magnetic fields, and their interaction will actually help us to rotate the motor. Okay, so let's say this thing. So there are a couple of other techniques, okay, for the starting for the starting of the single phase induction motor. This is the split phase winding which I was talking about, and we are going to study this thing in more details. The other two types are capacitor type winding and the shaded stator poles. Okay, so you can guys also, if you are interested, so you can read more contents about this thing in the book. Okay, so basically chapter these are the pages books which you guys can study to study the more details. I'm not going into the depth of the theory for this chapter. So let's say split phase winding. Okay, so as I was explaining, okay, that we have one main winding, okay, here, like this is the one main stator winding, and then we have the auxiliary winding here. Okay, so what we can do here, okay, so we make the ratio of the resistance and reactance of the auxiliary winding greater than the ratio of the resistance and reactance of the main winding. Okay, why we are making this thing? Okay, we are making this thing so that we ensure that actually the current IA, okay, it leads the current IM. Okay, when the this ratio is high, okay, and the current IA will lead the current IM. Okay, so that is our purpose here. But like also you can see that the main field winding and the auxiliary winding, they are placed at the 90 degree electrical to each other. Okay, so that is also the another reason we want to ensure that. Okay, so practically we place, this is the practical configuration. Like you have this main winding, and then you place the auxiliary winding 90 degree of the that one, or like the in-depth view is like this one. So like this is the main winding, and this is the auxiliary winding, which is the 90 degree of the your main winding. Okay, so this is the practical configuration. And then we have a switch here, which is actually called centrifugal switch. Okay, what is the purpose of this switch? Okay, but the purpose of this switch is that for example, due to the operation of the auxiliary winding current and the main winding current, finally we have the rotation of the rotor. So once rotor achieves its operating speed, Okay, at that time, this centrifugal switch will turn on and it will separate the auxiliary winding from the main winding. Okay, so this centrifugal switch is basically operating on the speed of the rotor. So once it reaches the threshold of the operating speed, at that time it will turn on and it will separate the auxiliary winding from the main winding of the stator. Okay, so let's analyze this thing. So like I was saying that IA should lead the IM. So let's say applied voltage is our reference. So of course we have the inductor here. So the IM will lag the will lag the voltage, and of course the current IA. Okay, so we make this ratio high so that it will lead the IM. Okay, so if I draw this, let me draw this. So basically what will be happening here? Okay, so in the rotor inside, okay, we will get the two magnetic fields. Okay, one will be the the BA magnetic field, and the other one will be BM magnetic field. Okay, so the BA magnetic field, because the IA is leading the IM, so its generating magnetic field will lead the main field magnetic field. Okay, now so as we so remember one thing, that the rotation of the magnetic field. Okay, so here if you take the product of the BA cross BM, okay, so then we will get the induced torque. Okay, and then finally our rotor will be rotating in the counterclockwise direction due to this effect. And once the rotor starts rotating, okay, our the rotor shaft is rotating, and once it reaches the operating speed of the rotor, at that time a signal will be sent to the centrifugal switch and this will be on. And once this on, this whole thing will be gone and we will have just our main winding and stator winding circuit. Okay, so this is just the operation. In this way we actually can produce the starting torque in the single phase motoring, and we can start our single phase motoring. So this is just a theory that how we can actually start the single phase motor. Okay, so this figure is just explaining the same thing which I was talking, that the line voltage, the IA, it will be leading the IM. So this magnetic field will be reading this one, and finally due to their operation we will get the counterclockwise rotation of the rotor. Okay, here, and once the rotor starts rotating, okay, so for example while we are operating the main winding alone, we know the starting torque was zero. Okay, but if we operate the main and plus the auxiliary winding, so we will have this some starting torque due to the different the interaction of these two magnetic fields, and due to this our rotor is rotating, and once it reaches its operating speed, for example this point, so at this point our centrifugal switch will operate. Okay, and the auxiliary winding will be gone. Okay, and then our rotor will be actually rotating with the desired characteristics. Okay, so this is just the operation, that how we can actually make the how we can actually start the single phase motor. Okay.